It's a cold January morning, and I've woke up with a job to do. Well, I wake up every day with a job to do. This morning, I've got to get 4 deer out of my way. Not that big of a job, not a big deal. It'll take about an hour. So, I've already got them skinned. They've been hanging about 5 days or so. They're a little bit frozen, but they're not frozen solid. Worst part about this job is that my hands are going to be really cold while I'm doing it. I got a little heater fired up under my table there so I can warm my little piggies up as I work. Now, since we use buckshot, you end up with pellets throughout your deer. So one of the trickier parts of me cutting up deer meat is getting the cuts I want without getting the shot up meat. Sometimes you get good shots, and sometimes you get lots of bad shots. This one's got a pellet in his gut, and a couple of pellets in his ribs. Looks like that pellet ripped through this way, came out his gut. Okay, so that was a forward shot. But then this side's got a broadside hit. But, I mean, we're just looking at ribs here and a little bit of back strap that'll be messed up. Here's a good one in the front shoulder. That's where you want to shoot the deer. So then this one, you don't use the front shoulders, but maybe we'll get some meat off of them. The back straps will be good. The back hams look totally untouched. That's what you want to see when you're looking at your deer, basically based on how somebody shot the deer and how it was killed. This one was shot in vital areas, not in his butt. This one's got a nice clean hams. Those will be real nice. Shot right in the rib cage, right where you wanted to shoot them. Very good. Front shoulders got pellets in them, but that one is gonna be a nice big neck roast. This one here, also, got pellets in his neck here. Pellets throughout the front shoulders and upper vertebrae, rib cage area. But most of the back straps would be good. So what you end up doing is you get back straps down to where the pellets went through. And then you got a little bit of loss in your back strap there. Hams are good. And then this one here, perfect shot, lower chest, front shoulders are pretty destroyed, but everything else on it is good. And this is the ultimate trophy here for your freezer. A nice young 6-month-old deer. The whole thing is like veal. Better than veal. I don't eat veal. This is my veal. I call it veal. Nice tender deer meat. So, let's get to work. But we can't do this without music. I don't care what YouTube says. I'm listening to the music.
Now, just below the back of the pelvis there, the front of the pelvis, I go across with my knife horizontally. Then I run my knife vertically down the vertebrae, down the spinal column, and get a nice straight cut down the side of the bones there. Just running my knife down bone the whole time. And then I come in again and start to peel it back with my thumb and just work my knife down the side of the ribs. Right down the top side of the ribs. Touching bone the whole time. This is not extra large jumbo back strap. This is a small, delicate little back strap. And you don't want to lose any of it in there. You get the whole thing out. Get all the meat on my table. And then I can just reach in, grab hold of it, and peel it off the fat like that. And what we've got is a beautiful, tender little back strap. And now my hand is frozen and numb. All right, I've regained feeling in my fingers, and I can take out the next. Sometimes you can just get in there and do most of the work with your hand. In that case, it worked real good. And there's another nice back strap. So basically, when I'm cutting up a deer,
the first thing you do is look at where the deer was shot, because that'll determine what cuts I take or how I take them.
In this case, this one, half of these loins are gonna be no good. I'll cut it out so we can see. But you will see when I get it out of there that the top half of them, the lower half, has been shot through.
Now there's an extra jumbo backstrap. You can see here where the shot ripped through the top half there. All that'll go to the dog or in the scrap pile, but the bottom half is good. Just like that, a beautiful backstrap. So now you can see where the pellets passed through these loins. I didn't even bother to cut them out, but I got a good section out of them anyhow. All back straps have been removed. They're on my table, and now it's time to clean them up. If I missed something, like here I can see a pellet has zipped through the bottom of this back strap. At least it looks like there's a hole here in the fat. But maybe it went that way through the ribs. I think it did. But we'll find out if we find a pellet in there, or if we find somewhere where a pellet ripped through and the meat's all destroyed and bloodshot, we'll have to trim that out. So the first thing I do is go along the top, and usually I've done a good job removing it. And in this case, I've done an excellent job. There's nothing to take off the top, the bottom, whichever. It's on the top now. And on this side, it'll be the same story. So what I'll do now is go along the bottom and just remove the silver skin as best you can without losing any meat. This is a tricky job, but when you do it enough, it is fun, an enjoyable experience for all involved. So I like to have a good bit of fun while I'm cutting these apart. And in the right circumstance, it just kind of peels off. But every time you start to peel it, you can get a little carried away. You're thinking like, okay, it's perfect, it's gonna peel off, and then I start to peel it, and then it doesn't cooperate, and you end up ripping your meat. When all this stuff's gonna get chewed up anyway and swallowed, but we do want it to look nice. You know, it's all about presentation. We can't have the women of the household opening up a package of back straps and finding a big chunk of deer hair or blood clot meat, something like that. It's gonna turn people away from the whole deer meat eating experience in my household. And that's not gonna happen because I do a really good job with it, and everybody's running around like a wild coyote eating deer meat every day. So here I've got all the fat and silver skin I've peeled off. We lost a little bit of meat in the favor of having a really nice clean cut piece of meat for my dinner. And then you put it on your table and you realize your table wasn't as clean as you had once thought. Pick up a little something, clean that off. Some of these veins that go through there you can try and pull out, but it's not that big of a deal. You ever seen all the veins in a chicken leg when you were eating it? A little bit of veins in my back strap's not gonna hurt. Or you can leave them in there and tell everybody else that comes to visit that they're worms. See those worms? Yeah, well, they're dead now, you can eat them. All right, so we throw that over there for later usage. This one here is out of that big deer. And again, I've done a real good job removing it, but you can see there's a little silver there, so I'm just gonna go ahead and peel that off. Again, this is my premium cut. Some people say the best cut is the tenderloin, the inner loin. I disagree, I think this is the best cut, even on a tougher deer. It's more of like a steak than the other one. And here I'm gonna peel down. Even though I pulled this meat out, I'd rather throw that meat in the grinder and mix it with my ground meat than have it attached to my back strap, because it comes with all that silver skin. Once I get down to the fat, the back fat there, I start to run my knife through and peel the back fat off of the meat. Just like a good surgeon, I separate the fat membrane from the muscle, and our end result will be pure backstrap muscle. And here we've got just a little bit of silver left here and a little bloodshot stuff. Let's take that off. We don't need that attached to our premium quality backstrap. Just like that. This one's gonna be tougher, but once you cook that gently, slice it up. Oh, baby. You just wanna get all that silver skin off as best you can. And if you like having a chewier kind of meal, you leave the silver skin in there. If there's people maybe you haven't, get some, you wanna punish your kids, you give them some of the stuff you don't wanna eat. What do I know? I'm just talking. All right, so here I go again, peeling. Putting my knife in there and just separating the fat from the meat. It's a lot easier to go to the grocery store and just buy some stuff and then eat it. Better yet, just go somewhere where they cook it for you and then eat it. But this is no quality of life. This is poor quality of life, in my opinion. I think the best thing you can do is catch your own food and do the whole process yourself. And then you'll be much closer to life itself. All right, putting my hand down on the heater now. I've done such a good job taking these out that it's pretty easy to clean them up. There's not a whole lot going on. We're gonna pull this worm out, trim him off. Okay. Now I know a lot of people are gonna shrug their shoulders or turn their nose up to the idea of eating some wild little animal off the shoulder of the highway, but I don't think they know a whole lot about anything. They ain't gonna bother me, that's for sure. I actually prefer the way it is, as much as I'd like to talk bad about people who eat regular food. But I prefer it stay that way. I don't want a whole lot of people running around trying to catch my deer. That would make it harder for me to do. Or at least less convenient, I think. I don't know, that's hard to say, because the couple of problems you have when you're trying to go out and catch your own deer meat is, number one, people despise it and don't understand it, right? That seems like that's the biggest problem. But I don't know if it is. I think the biggest trouble with going out and trying to collect your own deer meat is other hunters. Because other hunters, so here's how it goes. All these people, you see them, they have camouflage hats and shirt collars and stuff like that. They got camouflage wallpaper in their bedroom. They've got pictures of deer on their back windows, big bucks and bow and arrows. These people, I don't think, eat deer meat. Some of them maybe. But what they like to do is they take it and they'll get like a treat made out of it. You take it to the butcher and you can get some sugary snack made out of your deer meat. And you can say that you eat your deer meat, and then you feel better about having a picture of a deer and a bow hunter in your back window. Is you would think that the anti-hunter people would be the hardest part about trying to hunt without any complications. But really, these people who think they're trophy hunters are the bigger problem. So you go hunting and the idea is you're gonna kill this big trophy animal that nobody can catch. And that's awesome, that's great. That's that's one of the exciting parts about hunting for deer, is that they have big antlers on their heads, and anybody who likes to hunt gets very excited when they see them, because we know that for a white-tailed deer, especially where I'm from, where there's a overpopulation of people, has a hard time growing big antlers because they always die. If they don't get hit by a car when they're 6 months old, then they will be shot at some point or get hit by a car later. There's no, this is the hard animal to find, the white-tailed deer with the big antlers. So he's the trophy, and that's great. I like it that way, it's awesome. But there's many things, there's too many things involved in this. Well, for one, the less deer get harassed, the more comfortable they are, the bigger they grow, and the older they get. So people will do anything. People will kill each other over hunting rights because they want to be the only ones that can go into a special little piece of land. You go to a school or a cemetery or a park or a prison, something like that, and you find the biggest ones because no one goes in there, or not too many people go in there. I think the biggest buck lives on the governor's lawn, but then if I really think about it, I think the governor's security guard probably hunts the governor's front lawn, but maybe he only shoots the biggest buck because that's what the most hunters are after. They're not looking for the back straps. They're not looking for the tender meat. They're just looking for big antlers so they can say that they're the best hunter in the world. So then what you got is a bunch of jealous people running around in real tree camouflage, getting angry at everybody else who shoots button bucks. I shoot every button buck I encounter right in the face, and I eat them every day of my life, and I am very proud of that. But they don't look at that as something to be proud of. When I was a young boy and I got my hunting license, I went out and immediately started slaughtering deer. Antlers, no antlers, albinos, regular deer. I shot them all, everything that came near me, because I'm a hunter. But the other hunters, or so-called hunters, didn't appreciate that very much. And I learned very quickly that these people will kill you over antlers. It's still nice to be good enough at hunting that you can catch these deer. Now, that's a feat in itself, to catch the deer with the big antlers, the big buck. And that's something to be proud of. But if you have a little farm where you're the only one that's allowed to go there and you're only shooting the deer with the big antlers, then it's really not that hard anymore, is it? Some people still can't even pull that off. I think what I'm trying to say is, this is a beautiful backstrap and it's gonna taste good. Now here, I've thrown this part to the side, a pellet zipped through here and a pellet zipped through there and here. Oh, that one that went that way. So my shot went right through here and out this side of the back strap, just like that. Basically, this is a big pile of bloodshot, bone-ridden, pellet-infested meat. But I'm gonna take the middle section out. Oh, nope. Yep, we'll get a little chop out of it. I'm gonna throw that in there. I'm gonna eat that. And this one here looks good as well. Just the tail end of it is free of buckshot, so we get an extra little piece, extra little bite-sized piece in there. Very good. Throw that to the side, feed it to the cat. Now here's my tender little one, and it's not nearly as much meat as my giant backstrap. I mean, look at the difference in those two. But this one is not nearly as tender as that. Big difference in meat size, but a big difference in taste. I'm gonna have a good time eating this one. And I'm gonna run around like a wild jackrabbit after I eat it. Just like that, we've removed all silver skin and fat. Beautiful little loin it is. Now my little fingers are frozen solid once again, and I'll stick them in my pants and warm them up. While I do that, I'll talk to you about Eskimos. I don't know anything about Eskimos, but I've heard that they live in igloos. It's probably the biggest thing you have to worry about when you're cutting up your own meat and raising a family. You want to try not to scare anybody. Now, I'm the type of person that goes around chewing on pieces of raw deer, but I do that in my own time in the woods and the forest all by myself. When I come home, I can't have a raw deer heart hanging out of my mouth. I have to present this as a nice, clean, better alternative than what they sell at the store. And come to think of it, who the hell knows what you're getting when you buy a piece of meat at the store? Here's a little piece of silver skin from the ribs. I cut so close to the ribs there, we got a little silver skin in there. We're gonna throw that away because somebody's gonna be chewing on that and they're gonna wonder what they're chewing on. And then they're gonna think of this table or something like that. It's a piece of the table and my meat. And we can't have that. So just run my knife right along here. I'm gonna get a nice straight cut on the end of this back strap. And then we will come around the bottom and work my knife along the silver skin, the back fat there, and get a nice, perfect, clean muscle out of this. Some people, their whole thing, that's their whole thing. Like, they'll have a picture of a big buck on their gravestone, but I don't believe they ever sat down for very long cutting up back straps, processing deer meat. I don't even think they go hunting that much. I think I might hunt more than the guy that has the deer on his tombstone. I might hunt in the graveyard where the tombstone with the guy on his tombstone is buried. I bet he never hunted there. There we go. A nice, big, beautiful back strap. Now, I'm all out of back straps. That was only 4 deer. I'm so used to cutting up 40 or 50 deer at a time. This just feels like a little hobby, but that's okay. So we're gonna take this silver skin, file it in a bucket, and we'll give it to the critters out back or to my dog. Now we'll fold this up and wrap it up nicely. Try and get it to squeeze itself into a bag. I like to fill these bags pretty much full, and then it'll be a meal or two for my family, or three, because these are good cold too after you cook them. Now, I spend a little bit too much time thinking about a lot of things. And I wonder if I take the scraps from this deer and throw it in a garbage can. I have now forgotten my vacuum sealer, but that's okay, it's gonna be fine. If I threw that in a garbage can, it ends up in a landfill. And a landfill is a strange thing. If you go digging around in the dirt, and you found ancient artifacts, arrowheads and rocks and stones that people used. How often do these archaeologists look at that and go like, well, this was where they threw all this stuff out. This is the ancient dump. I wonder that because I wonder what whatever creature that discovers our landfills would think of us. Probably not think too highly of us, would they? Is there an ancient landfill outside of ancient Egypt? And if there is, what did they throw in it? I don't think there is. Or maybe everything that was in the ancient landfill in ancient Egypt or in South America and the Mayan people, did they have a landfill? Is their castle a landfill? No, I don't think the castle's a landfill. That doesn't make much sense. Where's their landfill? Why didn't these people have a landfill, and why do I have a landfill? Is there too many people? Maybe that's the trouble. I could agree with that. I think there's too many people. I think the coronavirus needs to do a better job at weeding some of these people out. Because a lot of people, I mean, even I'll say, the deer are overpopulated. Oh, the deer are overpopulated. There's too many deer. But what I'm really thinking is maybe that's backwards and maybe there's too many people. Maybe people are overpopulated and there's just not enough room for all of my deer. I would like a better coronavirus next year. Maybe not, but one could hope or wish or at least dream. Oh, I'm doing this backwards now. I got confused. I'm supposed to do paper first. Anyway. So you throw this thing in the landfill, but why? Why throw it in the landfill? I like to give it back to the forest, and then I wonder how important that actually is. I think very important. I think that all of this stuff that makes up a living thing is recycled. I think I'm built out of recycled material. I think if something never lived and died, and if a million things never lived and died, then I would never have a left arm. Or a right arm. Or eyeballs. I think you need to recycle yourself after you die, is what I'm trying to say. And so, any part of this deer that I don't use and recycle, I must also allow to be used and recycled. But then if I throw it in a landfill, and the bottom is lined, and the top is lined, and it's surrounded by plastic and plastic wood and fake things and artificial things and fake fur, then what happens to it? Does it become a rock? Does it become petrified? Does it become a piece of wood? I think there must be, if the birds and bugs don't get to it as it sits and waits to become buried in the landfill, which I think they would, I think if you threw meat in your garbage can and it went in a garbage truck and made its way to the landfill, at that point there must be maggots in it already, right? But it's wintertime, there's not many flies around. Still, there's buzzards and crows and seagulls. And there's still bugs underground. So once it's in the landfill, is the landfill filled with worms? It must be, right? So maybe there's still a chance for life to recycle itself, but maybe those worms just live in the landfill and they never get out. Maybe they can't escape to real life. Maybe I think too much about those things that don't much matter. But maybe these things are the most important thing that anybody has ever thought of. And nobody's thinking about it. Somebody's gotta be thinking about it. I'm not sure that people are recycling properly. I think the most important thing to recycle is probably life. Life must be recycled. I've never heard anybody else say that. Maybe I have no idea what I'm talking about. Still, I believe it. So, when I die, please don't put me in the landfill. Put me in the recycling bin. I'd like to go to the compost pile. Actually, rather, I'd be like to be eaten. If my grandchildren are willing, they can eat me. My last will and testament. Grandchildren, please eat me. Why? Because I need to be recycled. I need you to use my energy. My internal organs must be turned into more energy for life. That is how life goes on. Life eats life. Life must be recycled. I believe this. And that has been today's church session. Life must be recycled. Welcome to the Durrt Church. My name's Jimmy Durr, and today we will be learning about recycling life. That which lived must live again through me. Or you, if you eat me. Now give me $10. Last night I unfortunately saw a commercial for a vegetable burger. That's not a burger with vegetables on top of it. That's a burger that they claim is a burger that they claim is made out of vegetables. And I have to wonder if these sissy pants people who are trying to rule the world and change my life have ever met a vegetable farmer. Vegetable farmers, and this is exclusive, this is 100% guaranteed, vegetable farmers are the biggest murderers you will ever meet. They want to kill everything and anything that gets near their farm that wants to eat their vegetables. So why then would anyone ever consider a vegetable burker to be nice, or humane, or friendly? They wouldn't. These people are autistic. These people are special, and these people should be sent away to the bottom of the ocean. Just my personal opinion that I'm working out here as I talk to you. And you don't talk back, so this is really a one-sided thing, isn't it? And that's it. Just like that, I'm out of backstraps, and we're gonna move on to a different cut. This segment of the Durrt Church is brought to you by Abbott's, maker of fine, wonderful milk crates. Since we're not using it for its intended purpose, we'll call it a meat crate. Thank you, Abbott. We love your meat crate.